thank you so much for coming. It's such an honor for me as your Member of Parliament to have Rob Oliphant as our guest. I'm going to read from your biography because it's important. Rob was elected to the House of Commons the same time that I was in October, but he previously served from 2008 to 2011, so a lot more experience than me. He's currently chair of the House of Commons Committee on Public Safety and National Security and co-chair of the House of Commons and Senate Special Joint Committee on Physician-Assisted Dying. He has done 11 of these sessions, but they're all in Ontario. And he's come all this way because we've become friends and because of the high regard I hold him in. There's nobody better to describe the landscape in Canada on this issue and the struggle that we have. It's such a personal decision, but also incredibly important public policy. Most recently, before being elected, Rob was the president and CEO of the Asthma Society of Canada, a national health charity with educational advocacy and support programs for 3 million Canadian children and adults. He received his Bachelor of Commerce from the U of T and worked as a systems accountant. Who knew? He's also an ordained minister in the United Church of Canada and has a Master's of Divinity from the Vancouver School of Theology at UBC and has served congregations in Newfoundland, Quebec, Yukon, and Toronto. He earned a doctorate from the Chicago Theological Seminary at the University of Chicago in 2008. So, fascinating background. What I thought we would do with this evening was I will turn it over to Rob. He'll speak for 15 or 20 minutes about what it's been like for him on this journey with regard to medical assistance in dying. And then I'll explain together we'll explain where we're at as a country, what's going to happen next week. Last week was a little unusual, but we'll get back on track. And if it's all right with you, I'll turn it over to Rob at this point. Thank you. He said he needs the jewelry. How do I do it? Thanks. You may have seen him on Power and Politics, by the way.
A little bit once in a while. So I want to thank Pam first for the invitation. Not very many MPs have invited me, and I have always said yes, but I was delighted because I got to come home to Vancouver. I only lived here for 4 years. But my skin already feels better having been here for a weekend. Just wanted to check the folks here. How many from West Vancouver? Good. How many from Sunshine Coast?
Oh, no.
Sea to Sky Country. All right, just checking, because the best part about being in the House of Commons is when the Speaker calls Pam's riding and it goes on for about longer than any other riding. I want to tell you what a difference it makes too as a Member of Parliament. I worked with your previous MP and I had respect for him. I'm going to say very clearly that I did have respect for him, but you've upgraded. It's a very clear difference in the representation that West Vancouver and Sunshine Coast, Sea to Sky Country, I got it right, has in Pam as a representative. The other thing I always need to say is that she brings obviously her background in municipal politics and has that sense of building consensus, but she doesn't only represent West Van. She represents the rest of her riding. She also has the capacity to bring forth Lower Mainland issues as well as British Columbia issues, and I'm now seeing her as bringing Canadian issues. So thank you for sending Pam to Ottawa. It's making a difference already. A year ago, February, the Supreme Court of Canada upheld a decision that started in it was called the Supreme Court of British Columbia, that was then upheld in the Court of Appeal in British Columbia, and then finally went to appeal at the Supreme Court of Canada, and that's the case of Kay Carter. It wasn't just Kay Carter, there were actually two cases at stake, and it was Gloria Taylor and Kay Carter. Gloria Taylor was younger than Kay Carter. She had ALS, and Kay Carter had a disease called spinal stenosis. Both of them had extreme pain. Both of them wanted to get medical assistance, physician assistance, particularly at that time, in the final days of their life. They really wanted to have a sense that they could have a gracious exit. And so they took this case. Both of them died before the Supreme Court finally made its decision. However, Kay's daughter Lee and her son Price continued that journey, as did the BC Civil Liberties Association with their lawyer Joe Arve, one of the finest lawyers in Canada, on civil rights and on human rights. That case obviously made history. And when the Supreme Court of Canada made its decision, they struck down two parts of the criminal code, two sections of the criminal code which made it illegal for someone to help someone in the case of dying. And those two sections, section 141 and section 241B of the criminal code needed to be struck down so that doctors and those helping doctors, pharmacists, nurses, nurse practitioners, would not indeed be penalized for participating in medical assistance in dying. That Supreme Court decision was very clear, and essentially, in a nutshell, it said, for people suffering a grievous and irremediable disease, who have intolerable suffering to them, as they experience it subjectively, not that I say it's intolerable, but that the patient themselves says it's intolerable, those people, A, should not have to undergo treatments that are not acceptable to them, and that they should be allowed, if there's a physician willing, to allow that physician to help them die. Supreme Court, that was essentially the decision. It was quite a bit longer decision than that, but that was the essential decision. They didn't go at great lengths to define it, but they said that the government, they felt, would have the responsibility and also be the best place to set up the safeguards necessary and the kind of work that should go into ensuring that the vulnerable are protected, but that that right was guaranteed. The previous government didn't act on that decision right away. Then the third party leader, Justin Trudeau, put forward a motion asking that an all-party committee be put together with Commons and Senate. That was defeated by the Conservatives in the House of Commons. The government then finally set up what they called an external panel that would give recommendations. They eventually didn't give recommendations, but they did make about a 75-page report to the government. Concurrent to that, we had a federal election with a good result for some of us. And I don't assume you're all Liberals, by the way. Whenever we do these events, we always assume that there are people who didn't vote for us, and we hope there are people who didn't vote for us, because that's what we're trying to do, is making sure that we get out to our whole community. So my assumption is never that you all voted for Pam. Next time you get a chance to redeem yourself if you didn't. But for us, we felt it was a good election. We felt that the Canadian public said several things, and one of those things was an impatience with the Conservative Harper government and its lack of respect for the Charter of Rights and Freedoms. That was through several different pieces of legislation. In the process, the election happened. The provinces and territories put together their own expert panel and had the provinces engaged in it. The Royal Society of Canada, a group of academics, put together its panel. And then after the election, Mr. Trudeau asked the House of Commons and Senate to put together a joint committee with 10 MPs and 5 senators. Those were chosen based on the party proportions in the House of Commons. So on the MP side, 6 Liberals, 3 Conservatives, and 1 New Democrat with a vote and 1 New Democrat without a vote. And 5 senators, 3 Conservative and 2 Liberal. 2 co-chairs. I was elected as a co-chair from the House of Commons, and a Conservative was elected the co-chair from the Senate, Senator Ogilvie from Nova Scotia. We started working. We were appointed in late December, but got really going in very early January, and we're given a deadline of February 26th to have our report in. We met quite intensively, as many as seven times a week, for committee meetings, plus seven pre-meetings, plus other meetings. We were meeting about 16 or 17 times a week for those 4 weeks. We heard from 61 witnesses. We received 138 written briefs. And we also examined the external panel that Mr. Harper had appointed, their report, the Provincial Territorial Report, and the Royal Society of Canada report, and then took in international experience from Belgium, Netherlands, and Luxembourg, the three Benelux countries, as well as Switzerland, those four European countries which have assisted dying, plus four states in the United States that also have it. Tried to look at that international experience, combined it with Canadian jurisprudence and Canadian constitutional realities where provinces and the federal government share healthcare responsibilities, and then we came up with our report. When our committee started, I thought it was a very simple task. The reality was the Supreme Court had made the tough decision. They made the decision whether or not there would be assisted dying in Canada, and they had affirmed that under Section 7 of the Charter of Rights and Freedoms, despite the government arguing against it, under Section 7, that Canadians have that right. And so I thought, this is easy. We don't have to figure out why or whether. All we have to do is the who, when, where, and how. Easy. We got into it. It was very difficult. Who should be eligible for it? Who should assist? Where could it happen? In homes or in hospitals or both? When should it happen? Should advance directives be given or not? How should it happen? Should it be what's called voluntary euthanasia, where someone actually administers death? Or should it be the other thing, which is you do it yourself, which is essentially suicide, where you're doing medical suicide, where you get a prescription through a doctor from a pharmacist, but you administer it yourself? We went through these questions and it became very complex. Should there be judicial review before you're allowed, or should there be record keeping afterwards? Who supervises this? How is it done? What about faith-based medical institutions? Should they be allowed? Should doctors and nurse practitioners, nurses, pharmacists have the right to conscientiously object? If they object, do they have to make effective referrals? It became very complex. Then it got simpler. Went from simple to complex to simple. When we ultimately decided that this is more a medical decision than it is a legal decision. And that the covenant, the trust between patient and physician was the primary role that should be engaged in this question. That the questions of capacity and competence are best determined by medical practitioners, by physicians. The timing of it, the circumstances of it, should all be woven between patient and physician. Now, some safeguards we felt should be in there. We felt that to protect the physician as much as to protect the patient, there should be two physicians to make sure that there have been two physicians independent of each other involved in this decision. We felt, our committee felt, that age should not be the primary factor, capacity should be the factor. Now, the legislation is different from this, but we felt that over the next 3 years, we could move into people being under 18, start with 18 years of age and over, but said essentially a 17 and a half year old might be totally competent, an 18 and a half year old might not be. And so that age wasn't the issue, but capacity was. And we had psychiatrists who were divided on this. Some felt it was impossible to determine capacity. Others said they did it every day on other medical procedures. We looked at the issue of advanced directives, whether people should be able to give an advanced directive early, like a power of attorney or a living will. We didn't go that far. What we said was that once someone has a diagnosis of a disease that was grievous and irremediable and would likely lead to intolerable suffering, they should be able to put in place the instructions for when certain conditions happened that death would happen with them and for them. So limited advance directives. We didn't entertain anything around surrogate decision making. That, and some people wanted us to, they said that there should be the capacity for someone who has taken care of someone or someone who has a stroke, for instance, or has a brain injury and hadn't had obviously a diagnosis, but that someone wanted to end that life, we wouldn't go there. We said, no, that there are some decisions that should only be made by the person themselves, and that that kind of autonomy needed to be respected, but that society had to step up and care for them. So I always mention this, this is not about the Robert Latimer case. There is nobody able to make a decision for someone else, only the person themselves. They have to be competent and capable. They have to go through a very rigorous process with two physicians, and that in the end, the decision, however, should be theirs. Rigid, strict, robust medical records should be kept and reported. Every province and territory should have to report on these deaths, and that there should be record keeping to watch for unusual patterns in the way physicians were handling it. We felt that nurse practitioners should be allowed to be part of this process under the supervision of a physician, because prescribing of barbiturates, of the medications required, were not in their scope of practice, and we didn't think that the scope of practice was ready yet to be expanded. However, we know that in remote communities, nurse practitioners are often the primary caregivers and know their patients better, and that a teleconference consultation with a physician should suffice, as long as a physician has reviewed the case. So we made our report. All the Liberal MPs, all the Liberal senators, the NDP MPs, and the Conservative senators sided with the majority report. Three Conservative backbenchers put forward a dissenting report, and they felt that we were far too permissive and wanted judicial review prior and several other things that they put in their minority report. The government took the report and considered it, and then came up with legislation which came out about 6 weeks ago, and that's called Bill C-14. C-14 is a much more limited approach to the question than our report. I understand it as the first step towards a broader system over the next year. That's not, as some people would say, a slippery slope. It's about to get best practices and get the kind of experience that physicians need, that hospitals need, that people need, and to get it understood as part of medical care. We also, though, in our report, said there were four other things that we felt needed to go hand in hand with this. One was, we felt that Canada needed to really address the palliative care problems in this country, where we have unequal access to palliative care. You can have excellent palliative, and there's kind of two kinds of palliative care. There's capital P palliative care, where you're in a hospice or an outpatient to a hospice, and then there's small P palliative care, which most Canadians have, which is their family doctor helping them in their disease until they die. As a United Church minister for 25 years, there was never a family I met with that didn't want more palliative care. When someone we love dies, we want more. However, when we compare our palliative care in this country to the vast majority of inhabitants on this planet, Canadian palliative care is actually quite good. It's not good enough, and we felt it needed to be examined, and it can be improved. So palliative care is one thing. The other thing was around dementia and Alzheimer's. One of the big issues we're having is an aging population and really increasing amount of dementia in our society, which is my unabashed plea to my colleague to support Bill C-233, which is a national dementia strategy, which I co-wrote with a Conservative, Rob Nicholson, and we're precisely trying to bring about a dementia strategy into Canada that's 21st century, and that will look at research and also care. The third thing we looked at was a mental health strategy. That we have, Canada has a mental health strategy. We have a mental health commission. We need more, particularly with vulnerable Canadians, First Nation Canadians, younger Canadians, drug addiction issues. We are just not there as a country, and it does tie in tangentially to this question. And the fourth one was very specifically Indigenous Canadians, and that any kind of medical procedure that is being put across Canada needs to be mindful of the particular cultural differences of Canada's First Nations, of our Indigenous people. And we didn't have all the answers on that, because even though we tried very hard to get consultation with First Nations leaders and physicians, we only got two, and we felt we tried our hardest. We invited over 40, and First Nation communities are so stretched by being asked to be consulted on everything, you have to take a little bit longer to consult better. So we felt that that should still be done. I'm proud of our report. We had over 20 recommendations. A few of them made it into legislation. Not quite enough for me to support the legislation. What I'm very proud of is the Prime Minister has said it's a free vote, and he is encouraging MPs to vote with their conscience and with their understandings of different issues, and without any, we hope, career ramifications. It could be a career limiting move. But he has said not, and that he will respect MPs on conscience votes to do that. So I'm very proud of the Prime Minister for doing that, and I'm proud of the Minister of Justice, the Minister of Health, who have come up with the first piece of legislation, and we are in the process of about to vote on it. We've had, the way Parliament works, we've had the first and second reading of the bill. It went to the Justice Committee, a few amendments were made. It's back now at the House of Commons at what's called report stage, where the committee is reporting its findings and 11 amendments to the legislation, which we'll be voting on probably next Monday. And then we'll have a vote at third reading. Then it will go to the Senate. They're going to meet in what's called Committee of the Whole to go through the legislation to try to do it as quickly as possible. There is a deadline of June the 6th to have new legislation in place. I am not personally worried about that. I met this morning with the BC Civil Liberties Association. And they're very clear that there's not a tremendous vacuum, that we can live with this till we get the right legislation. So if we make the deadline, I think that's good. If we don't, it's not a crisis. We will have legislation in place, and Canada will yet again be a leader in human and civil rights. And other countries, I know, as in almost every other issue, we haven't always been first, but we've usually been second or third, and then the other larger countries follow. So that's a long story. The last thing I'm just gonna say is the question of assisted dying is not the question of life or death, living or dying. It's the question of pain and suffering or a gracious end. And I think that we have to always get that. The second thing is, it's a deeply personal matter, and there will be differences of opinion in this room. Nobody will be required to have assistance in dying. I fully expect I'm not going to take it. I'm the type of person who's going to complain right to the end, and I'm going to bring those I love with me suffering along all the way, and partly because I want to see that journey. At the same time, I'm kind of glad that if things got really bad, there's a way out. And for people who need that more than I do, for whatever reason, I respect it. And for those of us who are going to suffer to the end, I respect that too. Thanks.
So you can see why I wanted our community to hear from you, Rob. Really, there's just nobody better. It's true, you've been very public about the fact that you're not going to support the legislation that the government is introducing. I am going to support it. I recognize how much farther we have to go, and I'm looking forward to working with Rob and to hearing from you about the issues of, in particular, advanced directives, mature minor, protection for practitioners as well, and the conscience of doctors and other healthcare practitioners. Those are very, very important. It was suggested that there that be the ongoing discussion Canadians need to have, but I think we need to have a deadline and a reporting back stage with regard to that. I'm not sure if you know that Lee Carter, who's Kay Carter's daughter, lives in our riding. And when the after the fabulous report that your committee produced was after that was tabled, and then after the government came back with a much narrower view, but I think a very good start, rather than being in denial about it, which is what we had previously, she phoned me, and I don't think she would mind me saying, but she just said, "Pam, what happened?" She's profoundly disappointed in that we didn't accept all the recommendations. But when you look at the country as a whole, when you recognize the weight of opinion that is against all of this period, which is we can't really worry about too much because of what the Supreme Court said, and when you look at how we bring people along every step of the way, I agree with Minister Philpott and Minister Wilson-Raybould that this is a first step, but we have so much more to do. So rather than act like you haven't accomplished a lot and forged incredible bonds with this committee, I think it's important that this is out there, because it really is only the beginning. And in the spirit of democracy talks and our community and our ability to handle contradiction and difficult questions, I thought it was just really important to hear directly from Ra. At this point, we would both love to entertain your questions because it's my job to represent you, and I believe we're really only at the beginning. So the pressure that, never think of this as, I don't agree with you, think of this as pressure on me and in concert with Rob to achieve what is exactly what you just said, compassion for one another and for ending suffering, if that's what someone would wish for. It certainly doesn't compel anybody whatsoever to end their life in any way other than they would wish. So we have a microphone, I think. Yep. Is that, Lucy has a microphone. So any questions, comments?
Thank you. I'm Pete Shakerholm from Lions Bay. The first thing I did when I was gonna show up tonight was to read the Supreme Court decision and make myself a bunch of notes, to go and read the decision of the Alberta Court of Appeal, which just looked at this draft legislation, really, in considering a case that came before it, and also to go over the draft legislation in some detail. And I'll tell you why I would find it disappointing. I'm very glad, first, let me say, that this government is putting this forward, because every nurse, every doctor that I've talked to has said it's important and it's a good thing to see out there. And whew, and I wrote to Pam and said that. Very glad the government has put it forward. But I'm disappointed because what's in the legislation specifies right now that in order to request your medical assistance in dying, you have to be in a terminal condition or diagnosed as about to die or likely to die. And the Carter case, this is the one that Pam referred to, was the case of a woman who wasn't about to die. She was just intolerably suffering. And the Supreme Court pronounced on that. The Supreme Court said that she was in this case of intolerable suffering, and her security, her right to life, was being affected because she'd have to kill herself in order, by violent and dangerous means, to get out of her intolerable suffering, or else she'd have to stay in intolerable suffering, which affects her security of the person. So I trained in economics, not law. Anyway, I'm making a long comment. I'm disappointed that I feel that this legislation is too limited. I'm really sorry that the draft legislation has turned out as it is. It's a good step. Please carry on, but not enough.
I'll comment a little bit on this, because you won't all have followed the kind of legal procedure. What happened after the year deadline came up
The government asked for an extension of 6 months. They were granted 4 months extension. That 4 month extension, though, had in it, as a safeguard, that anybody requesting assistance in dying would have to go to court first to prove their case, and then and have two physicians as well, and then they could receive assistance in dying. What that has done is it's created now some case law, some jurisprudence from a number of people who have received assistance in dying. One of those cases was a case in Alberta where a woman who is 58 years old has ALS. She's not terminal. That was one of the first cases. And then the second case in Alberta was the case of a woman with mental illness, but it had manifested itself over 30 years into intolerable suffering. The physicians, including a psychiatrist, ruled that she was competent. The court upheld her decision. The government appealed it. They lost on appeal. And the argument that was used was basically the argument of the new legislation, and the three judges in Alberta in the Court of Appeal overturned it. And I think what this tells us, and I'm only nine people will decide eventually whether this law is constitutional, but I am pretty sure that with the Alberta decision that was rendered last week, a week and a half ago, that this law will be overturned very quickly. And what sometimes happens in Canada is legislators move a little bit, the court pushes them some more, legislators move a little bit, courts push them more. That's sort of the way we do things in Canada. I was hoping we wouldn't have to do it this time because I don't want very ill people to have to go to court. That bothers me. But I'm soft. I'm a United Church minister. I think the other part of that is I think when I look at my colleagues in the House, not many have dealt with death the way I have. I talk about death easily, and most people don't. I've done 680 funerals. I've been with hundreds of people in intensive care. I've worked with families as they're trying to let someone go. Some people are very worried that, you know, if we have this kind of law, someone is going to try to, you know, push mom or dad away to get into the will, to get the will. I've never experienced that. I've experienced the opposite. What I've experienced are elderly people who are saying, can you help my son or daughter let me go? I'm ready to go. And they're hanging on. That's been my experience. And life and death questions are my bread and butter. That's what I did for 25 years. But that's not normal. So it may be that the Supreme Court has to push the Parliament and the Parliament pushes people. I don't know. My town halls have been running about 75% or 80% saying we should go further.
Really?
Yeah, about that. 87% of Canadians over five different polls over 18 years support assisted dying. 87%, including 83% of Roman Catholics.
Really?
That's you know, there are still 17% who don't, but that's where people are. I think it people see it as humane. I think they see it as about suffering, and they're looking for safeguards. I did one whole workshop like this with all disabled people. There were I don't know 70 or 80 people, 60 in wheelchairs, just to let you know. And it was interesting because some of the disability groups were saying you have to protect those with disabilities. Of course we do, but we also have to protect people with disabilities' rights to get everything that the non-disabled have. Absolutely no one should ever be pressured into assisted dying, but just because someone has a disability or a mental capacity, or a mental illness, if they have capacity, I think their rights should be. But you're right, we push. I think Jean Chrétien talked about getting out of a snow rut that way.
I should also let you know that I invited Minister Wilson-Raybould tonight, and she just couldn't let me know until really yesterday that she couldn't come, but she did try because it's an interesting debate to hear between the two. So this is Rob's view and the committee's view, but and you're pretty good at it. But
I didn't win.
Well, but you really, really throw the ball far down the field, and we have to live into that now as a society. Next question.
Jackie Geisen, I have two questions. You've started to answer the first one, which is, what happens if the bill doesn't pass? What happens if the bill passes? My stated goal would be that it improves. So what happens in those two scenarios? My second question is, the number of things that were not included, some of them are very controversial, you can understand that. The one I don't understand is the advance directive. That doesn't seem that controversial. Can you explain why that wasn't included and what we can do to advance that, to not hold it back with some of the other, perhaps more controversial aspects? Thank you.
So if the legislation passes, there's a commitment written into the preamble that other issues get examined. And the minister has said she'll begin that examination on June the 7th, the day after it's in law. So that's the commitment. I think there is an understanding that it doesn't go far enough. We're not in cabinet. We don't know the discussion that goes on in cabinet about these kinds of bills. There would have been a robust discussion, and this is where they ended up. If the bill doesn't pass, one of the meetings I had today was actually on that issue. I can give you a one pager. And they essentially, the colleges of physicians and surgeons across the country have all put in, they're all provincial bodies, have put in systems to be in place to protect both the physicians and the patients. And I read them through today, and I worked with the BC Civil Liberties Association, and we're convinced that it would be fine, that there's not going to be any great problem.
But it requires a legal challenge.
It will require a legal challenge at some point, yes. And I think people are lining up to do that, unfortunately, but some people like that. The other issue about advanced directives, and I think to be fair to the government, I think they started to look at it and said, oh, this feels big. And we don't quite know how to do that. It feels bigger than a do not resuscitate, a DNR, which is people often have to sign in hospitals, or a power of attorney, or a living will, because you would have to find some system whereby there's an evaluation of a condition at some point. So the example would be, I'm diagnosed with Alzheimer's, and our problem without advanced directives is we think, because people are worried about losing capacity at some point in the future, they actually take their own life or have assisted dying before that point, because they're worried they wait too long and it passes them by and they're no longer capable. And so that's why we think advanced directives don't shorten lives, they lengthen lives. There's a pretty famous case of a woman in BC who's argued that. The problem is that no one's quite figured out then what the format is or who would be responsible for writing down the conditions that needed to take place. Now, I have an insurance policy that is some kind of a caregiving insurance policy, because I don't have kids. When you don't have kids, you have to think about your future, who's going to take care of you. And so I got one of these insurance policies. If three of these five things, or two out of these six, I forget what they are, happen, then my insurance policy kicks in, because I can't bathe myself, or I can't take solid food, or they have a list. I thought we should be able to get something that's pretty easy like that, that you would say, when those things happen, then the power of attorney kicks in and someone is able to make that decision. However, I think they struggled with it. And so they're gonna keep struggling with it. And if people have ideas, it would be helpful.
Yeah, we listened to Minister Philpott. As a medical doctor, she says people think they may wish to give an advance directive when they've been diagnosed with Alzheimer's, and then we see them living and it's okay. And so they wouldn't necessarily, or their family wouldn't have wanted them to end their life. Or then on the mature minors question, We have parents saying, oh my goodness, like my child was beside themselves, you know, has attempted suicide several times, but now they're fine and they're healthy. So, you know, there's this huge aspect, I think, of conscience that has led the government to say, let's get this done, let's make this the law, let's put these questions out and let's understand the subtleties of them. The worst part is people who are suffering now, who would wish to have certainty, and that I think is challenging for everybody.
Gentlemen.
Oh, sorry, Lucy's in charge of that.
Rob, can you comment on the committee's the narrow fixation on pain as the key indicator, rather than a broader concept of quality of life? This Alzheimer example we've been using is a good example, where pain is not going to be the right indicator. Did your committee struggle with that? What other options were there?
We ended up choosing the Supreme Court words very clearly, intolerable suffering, without the word pain. Because we decided, and it had to be subjectively defined, because physical pain or loss of dignity, or those are other suffering, I think, is a broader word than pain. We had the legislation uses the word incurable, which was not in the Supreme Court decision. The word was irremediable. There's a little difference there, because a disease may be curable, but you have to take 72 chemo treatments, and you have to chop off your left leg and your right ear, I don't know, something that is not something you want to do. But it could be curable. But that's why we think, in this kind of thing, the person has the right to say, this for me is intolerable. You get into issues with mature minors, which are quite difficult. And I had the thought on that, and I used a line from 6 Feet Under, the TV show, where the guy said, if your parents die, you're an orphan. If your spouse dies, you're a widow or a widower. Your child dies. There's no word for it, because it's just too awful. And I've been with families like that. And I think with an elderly person, we think death is better than suffering. With a younger person, I think we tend to say suffering is better than death. I think that's human nature, and I get it, because it's the death of hope, it's the death of the future. And so I get the fact, however, I worry about sentencing a young person to suffering that we're not sentencing an old person to. So it's not black and white. There's a lot of gray in this.
I think it's me, isn't it? I want to follow up on the advance directive. I'm wondering, is there a jurisdiction anywhere in the world that has legislation that covers advance directive?
You're nodding yes. I don't believe there is.
I have a question as well.
Yeah, I don't believe there is.
So that would also made Canada a bit of a...
Yeah, we would be out there on the edge on that one. So I get that too. One of the little problems though in the legislation is that it does say you need to reaffirm your decision immediately before death is administered. So the legislation was written a 15-day cooling off period, amended now to 10 days, but then the physician needs to reaffirm, which is almost the opposite of an advance directive. That's pretty tough, because if you're on morphine, you've got to stop the morphine to become competent to make the decision a second time. I have trouble with that. And I've talked to a lot of doctors about it, and they just said, oh, we won't do it. We can't do it, because we can't put people through that suffering. So that little part has been a problem for me. But it's advanced directives, I get. We have some time to work on this. I think that the colleges of physicians and surgeons are going to put together task groups, and they're going to get the best thinkers, and we're going to get what's called consensus practice guidelines, and we're going to figure it out as a society, and then Canada will lead.
We have a lady back here.
Okay.
And then over
here. One thing I do is, who has a question? Who's going to think they have a question? Put up your hand. Okay, I'm going to give you a number. Okay, keep your hand up. 1, 2, 3, 4,
five, six, seven, eight. Remember your number. Okay.
One.
We had one back there, and then the new one. The new one.
Yeah. I think you're zero. Can you guys hear me?
The big zero.
Okay, I'm Francesca Knight from Squamish, and Rob, I'm so delighted that you're here and to hear you speak. I'm going to very quickly tell a story of why this issue is so passionate to me. In 2007, my dad was diagnosed with lung cancer. He rejected chemo. He was absolutely terminal. He went in the backyard and he shot himself. So I'm not telling you guys because this is something, you know, it was not a suicide to me, right? It was why this is so important. So my question to you, and again, I'm so glad you're so knowledgeable on this, because I feel like I've skipped over a lot of the subtleties that Pam alluded to and said, we need something now. So my desire is to support this, even though I definitely have a better understanding now of why it has severe shortcomings. So my question is, do we just take the deal now because we really need something? Or in your opinion, is there another process where we get a better deal? Or yeah, I think you get my point.
So on that, it's a yes and, not a no but. It's a yes and. I am confident the bill is going to pass. I'm confident. That gives me, frankly, Pam is being gracious to give me the opportunity to keep pushing this. So what if we have a team here. And so the bulk of our caucus is going to support this legislation to get it in. And then there's a little group of us that are going to keep pushing. And if, frankly, the way people work, if I voted for it, I would lose some ability to keep pushing on it next week and the week after and the week after. So I'm given the advantage of having a caucus who's going to push it through. I get that. And they're giving me the ability, and our prime minister graciously is giving us the ability to keep pushing. So we will do it.
Thank you. Can I be question nine?
I picked this up. This method comes from Kathleen Wynne, the Premier of Ontario. We share the same riding and the same boundaries. She taught me this 8 years ago. And it kind of works, that people don't fight for the mic.
My name is Margaret Ramsey, and I live in West Van. And I'm getting on in age, and I find this a very interesting topic. But it seems that the legislation is a very good first step. And I would just wonder, is there an amendment process? I mean, can we look forward to that? Because it seems if we could get it started, then some of these difficulties could be worked out with more thought and more understanding.
Let me just read this to you.
We're debating amendments next week, aren't we?
Yeah, but the actual legislation is quite good on that.
In other words, what we're trying to do is tick the we're underway box and then define what the next questions are for us.
So it says, in the whereas, at the beginning of the legislation, whereas Government Canada recognizes the living conditions of Canadians, there are diverse circumstances, different groups have unique needs, and commits to working with provinces, territories, and civil society to facilitate access to palliative care, end-of-life care, and services for individuals living with Alzheimer's and dementia. It goes on, and I'm looking for the better words. It's in the other section, sorry. The committee to which, at the start of the fifth year after the day on which the Act received royal assent, the provisions enacted by this Act are to be referred to the committee of the Senate or the House of Commons or both, so they may be established to review all the provisions, and that they should submit a report to the House.
So 5 years?
It'll be 5 years.
What do you think about that?
I think the minister has already said to us, it will have to start right away. Yeah. My job is to keep lighting the fire. That's my job.
It's too long.
Yeah. So that's at the very worst, it'll be 5 years. Mm-hmm. But you'll see that. Don't worry about that.
Thank you.
Two. No, you two.
Well, again, my issue is the advance directive. And of course, and I think the idea of Alzheimer's I do not understand why me as a competent person now, filling out a form that says I do not want to be fed, I do not want to have any medical procedures except pain control, why that can't be part of this legislation. So that would cover the idea that when I am no longer competent, I don't have to do something about it until I'm no longer competent, and there it is, I've written it down.
Part of that you still can do. I mean, and it's in provincial legislation, you are able to give those kinds of directives except for actual hastening of death. So in terms of care being extended, you can put those orders in place, and everyone should, but we haven't gone yet to the part where they actually would take measures to actually terminate the life. So part of it's there, just not all of it. And one of the other problems in the legislation is it's provincial jurisdiction, some of that. So I think that they wanted to get the legislation done quickly, and it's not partisan, but if Mr. Harper had started on this legislation instead of leaving it till after the election, we might have been able to do a better job too.
Yes.
Number three
is okay. Where's four?
Three was answered.
Four is okay.
Nancy McDonald. Back to the advance directive, which I think most of us are worried about. To me, it is a very subjective thing. And I think that they are perhaps trying to put in place too many minuscule items to avoid, rather than having the person themselves define what will be intolerable suffering at that time. To me, I have already done that. And I've put it in place, and I've put it in writing, and my whole family knows about it. But that doesn't make it legal. So that's...
There's something very Canadian about you. Let me tell you. I think you and the Supreme Court would get along just fine. Let me tell you a story. So here's my mother. My mother, Muriel, is 93, pushing 94, almost 94. And she owns her own house, she lives by herself, she drives a car, she's in Two Bridge Club, she goes to church every Sunday, she bakes casseroles for sick people, she makes cherry loaves when they're happy and date nut loaves when they're sad. She has a whole system. She is quite clear to me that when she's no longer of help to people, she might as well go. You look up Protestant United Church Woman, my mother's picture is there. Because she has it, and what we're trying to do with her is to say, you are not of value because you do things, you're of value because you are you. Mm-hmm. And so that's where I push my mother and say, you know, you don't need to end your life quickly. Just if you can't do everything you always did, you're still of value to us. Her best friend is Lucille. Lucille is, my mother's deaf. And Lucille is blind. They're the perfect couple. They go everywhere together. My mother can't hear, and she has 10% hearing, 10%. So we were already talking about lip reading. She's been deaf a long time, and Lucille's has macular degeneration. They take care of each other. They built their houses, their husbands, and they built their houses in 1959. They've been on the same street since 1959. Raise their kids together. They do everything together. Lucille's a Roman Catholic. My mom's a Protestant. Lucille says my mother is stupid. She should just relax and enjoy life, go to Mass, take communion, she'll be fine. And she says, if you suffer more, you get closer to God. That's her idea. So my mother says, no suffering, I'm out of here. Lucille says, suffer, suffer, and then you get close to God. They're both wrong, my humble opinion. They're both wrong. Somehow we have to move down this middle road where people are of value simply because we exist. We're of value. And suffering is not of value. Goodness and grace are of value. So that's my little sermon there.
I think we're a little mixed with the numbers. Five or four. Well, we'll make you four. Where is five or four?
Hi, I'm Peter Schofield.
I'm one of those that thinks it's a bit too lenient, and that's based on my experience with three elderly relatives that I had that I watched and visited and one cared for a lot that went through the final years in dementia. Two of them were in that state for a number of years, and I right to the end, I still enjoyed visiting them, even though they didn't recognize me. I got some pleasure from their existence in that state, even though they didn't know who I was. The third was not as pleasant. This person did not recognize me, could not do anything. And that was hard on me, and it was hard on the rest of the family. So I'm one of those that would like to see this advanced directive feature included. And you mentioned amendments. I understand now. I thought amendments were you could put an amendment in next week and they would change the bill. But what you said is its amendments would be considered in a later. There would have to be a new.
They'll have to be considered within a certain time, but they could come in any time.
Well,
there's
could.
Nothing to stop a government from moving faster,
yeah.
But they could come in. That might come in later. Have to come in later.
Yes, okay. If they weren't going to come in later, I was going to ask both of you the question. Would you consider changing your vote if there were amendments to your that would affect your vote in any way?
Sure, absolutely. That I voted for the bill at second reading because it went to committee, and I thought that committee could make some important changes. They didn't, so that puts me in an awkward position. The Senate, however, could make amendments. And in the end, I could vote for it. I never say never to anything. So that's always possible. My suspicion is the bill will largely be as it is, and I will, over the next couple of years, continue. But I mean, just to put a plug in, this morning I met with the Alzheimer's Society of British Columbia and working on a dementia strategy, our national strategy. I was enlisting them to push it in BC. They do provincial work. But I said, we need a federal strategy that could be an umbrella of research, whereas the delivery of healthcare is at the province, but every province needs to push the federal government. And we talked about end of life, and they said they're in a very difficult position as a society because they see people who seem to be living quite well with dementia. And I said, of course. And if someone has decided that they want to live with dementia, we respect that, and we support it, and we fund it, and we make sure no decisions are ever made based on economics or lack of care or anything like that. The difference is the person who decides they don't want that, and then we respect that as well. That's my goal.
I forget, five, six?
I'm six.
Okay, so I think we're on six.
Oh. At some point, you make it up when you forget.
you'll get it.
If you
keep using this method, people get good at it.
Well, first of all, I want to say that I'm supportive of the legislation in principle, and I understand its process, and most of the questions that I had and concerns I had when I came here have been addressed. But the one thing you did mention earlier that I wanted to discuss is the feeling that I have that as a Canadian, that I think it would be an absolute tragedy if people felt they had to make this decision because it was the best solution in absence of good quality palliative care. And I think that really this issue has to go hand in hand with we as a society addressing that every Canadian has equal access to good quality palliative care. And from my understanding, for instance, right in this riding alone, we don't. You know, we have great palliative care at Lionsgate, whereas on the Sunshine Coast and up the Sea to Sky, they don't have that access. And if they want to get it, it would mean leaving home, leaving their family, and dying alone, and choosing to die without pain or without your family. I don't think that's something as a society we should have to force people to make that decision.
You're here?
Yeah, here.
So I've got the dementia bell. I've got genetic discrimination, and then palliative care is next. So it is all of the, I'm somehow the health guy doing all these little bills. One thing I do want to say, though, is that in Europe, where they've had assisted dying now for not a generation, but close to it, it's about, it's between 2.2 and 2.7% of deaths are assisted. So it's 97, over 97% are deaths that are not assisted, and it's say 2.5 to 3% are assisted. In Oregon, which we think is closer to Canada in our social fabric, it's 0.3%. So the MP from Yukon, who's my very good friend, but he's a numbers guy, and he said, how many people will this affect in Yukon? And so we did that. We modeled from Oregon to Yukon, and over 21 years, we can anticipate 7 people. So he said, oh, it's okay, I don't need to worry about it now. But that, so it is small, you know, so don't get all nervous about it. It doesn't mean we don't care about palliative care, we have to, but don't start to think that we're into a epidemic of assisted deaths.
But the need for palliative care affects an awful lot of people.
Just look at us.
And my only experience is Lionsgate Hospital and how wonderful that is.
St. Paul's is terrible. Just kidding.
But I didn't realize that only 17% of Canadians, I think that number's right, have access to palliative care. I had no idea, because it's here, it seems like we do, but we're here to make the law for all Canadians, and the fundamentals of good law is that it's equal and it's accessible for all people. So that is a huge, huge issue, and I think a lot of real momentum around this as a result of this discussion. It just sort of naturally goes with it.
Number 7.
It's been answered.
Okay. 8?
It's been answered, thanks.
9.
Well, hi.
Lucy has a mic. Would you like a
mic? I'm gonna take Lucy home with me.
I'm here because my wife's been in a home for Alzheimer's for 9.5 years. And just before I came here, I opened an envelope and there was a request that when she dies, 10 days ago, she was put on palliative care. Despite what you may hear tonight, that's really, in many cases, a bookkeeping arrangement that allows them to get a better grant from the government. It makes no difference to an Alzheimer victim. The request is that when she dies, they be allowed to cut off her skull, remove her brain, because she's got something in the brain that's of particular interest for these scientists. I asked what happens to the body, and they said, and this wasn't a personal thing, oh, that's up to you. I actually remember the woman shrugging her shoulders, that's up to you. This is the reality. I mention this not because I want to get the conversation back onto this, but I want to get the conversation onto you folks, because I circulate, fortunately, wildly, socially, and people ask me, you know, are you married? And I say, yeah, but my wife and this usual thing. I'm amazed at that this topic comes up. And one thing I've known about Canadians, thank God, they never discuss politics, not even elections, very rarely. You guys didn't get elected, the last guys got kicked out. And they got kicked out because, you know, those lovely, calm, polite Canadians, by God, they get impatient. And you're onto something that's gonna make people impatient. They got the feeling you were going to act and you wouldn't BS them. And you know, a lot of the things you've done tonight is a bit of BS. Pam, you introduced this man as a wonderful guy. He proved to be wonderful. And you immediately jumped up and you said he's a wonderful guy, but I'm not going to follow him. And the government isn't going to follow him. So maybe you've got to go back and tell the guys who are popping it, if you want to be there for 8 years, the top guys have got to rethink this. Mm-hmm. And everything you've said, I think, might bear me out. And maybe some of the reactions here tonight.
Give us a little patience on this one. Now, one thing I do want to say is that when I announced to caucus I wouldn't support the bill, and Pam had invited me, I said, you might not want to invite me. And she said, oh, even more so. She says, because that's what democracy talks is about. That's what this is about. So
that's what our community is about.
Yeah, that's what your community is about. Absolutely. So she said, I need to tell you, your every meeting I've had has been the same. Correspondence we've received is about the same. The government is still the government and is going to find a way to move this kind of slowly. So just be a little patient. You should judge us if we let you down. But just keep giving us a little bit of movement on that. I'm completely loyal to the government. And as I said, I've got the chance to get on. I'm not an advocate for assisted dying. That's not my thing. But I'm going to do it now, because I've heard these stories every time I go out. We're going to keep doing it. And I think Pam is going to do it and other people are going to do it. We take on a different thing. This morning they were asking me at the BC Alzheimer's Society, they said, do you have MPs you would suggest to be a champion? I did give your name. And I said, we need strong, smart MPs to take on issues. So someone in BC's got to take on palliative care and dementia at the federal level. Very different than provincial. Provincial got to do the healthcare delivery. Federally, we have to get the framework right and the research right. All of that, though, is, I should have prefaced with it, thank you for the gracious way you're living your life. And it's my assistant, when I was a minister, had a husband with Alzheimer's. And she wrote a book called The Long Way Home. And it got quite a bit of press. She wrote that book, and she said it is just a long way home. And she said very few people know what it's like to have a spouse with Alzheimer's, except those who have it. And their children know it, but not in the same way a spouse does. It is so hard, and obviously you've got a good community, and obviously something is working, but we got to do more. And we'll figure it out.
The two questions over here, one hand.
Okay, and then you have one as well, and then maybe that.
Maybe some nurses though.
Yeah.
Waiting for the nurse.
Mark Alexander, why do we need legislation at all? The Supreme Court has said that we should make this not illegal. And why are we bringing in legislation? Whole debate went on around abortion and so on. They just didn't bring in legislation, and it got worked out across the country. So I'm a little mystified by that.
We went,
and I'm sure you had that discussion within your committee, and I'd be interested.
We went through that, and the reason we actually suggested legislation, what happened with abortion is they couldn't come up with a law that would work, and so essentially became a medical procedure. We don't have legislation about heart surgery either. The provincial health ministers asked the federal health minister for legislation so that we would have a system across the country that was not a patchwork. And they felt there needed to be a federal framework. I think one of our problems is that the legislation still has left a lot to the provinces anyway. However, I think that what Canadians are worried about is that there need to be safeguards. The colleges of physicians and surgeons do most of that, and I think Canadians trust them, but they also want the government to do something. So they're going to try legislation. I've always thought that the legislation should be lightly held as opposed to be a heavy-handed legislation. There was a cabinet minister named Stephen Fletcher in the Conservative government. Stephen is a quadriplegic, and he came to testify to our committee, and he is a complete libertarian. Almost no government is good government. I'm the opposite. I'm a left-wing liberal that government should work.
We agree on this issue, though, because he's coming at it from saying less, and I'm coming at it from saying less, but for different reasons. So we'll see how it comes. I think we'll have legislation, but it'll still be your colleges of physicians and surgeons, as well as the College of Nurses, because the legislation has included nurse practitioners as well. So it'll they'll be involved.
Jackie Geisen again. I'd like to offer a quick narrative for you in the hopes that it helps you move forward, in particular around the advance directive. I'm going to read this. Two close friends of ours, passed away from Huntington's disease. There's a lot of talk about Alzheimer's. There are worse things. Huntington's is described as having Alzheimer's, Parkinson's, and schizophrenia all at once. Huntington's is a genetic brain disorder that destroys lives. There is no cure. All children of Huntington's have a 50% chance of inheriting the disease. Death usually occurs 15 to 25 years after the onset of the disease. And it doesn't occur from Huntington's, but from complications such as choking, heart failure, infection, or aspiration pneumonia. Your body ceases to function while your brain continues to be active. These two people, a sister and a brother, both suffered horribly through the final years of the disease, which lasted between 5 and 10 years, with rapidly declining ability to speak. These family members lived in the Netherlands, where the possibility for them to change that course of their end of life existed. But they were not able to take advantage of that country's legislation. In one case, we could not tell if she would have made that choice. She was unable to speak or communicate for many, many years. In the second case, we knew the brother, he wished to make that choice for medically aided dying. But because of the inability to speak his wishes clearly and convincingly, he was unable to compel the doctors and family members to agree. I really encourage you to consider whatever you can do to move the advance directive forward as quickly as possible. Thank you.
Thank you for that. I will just make one little plea now, another one for Pam. There's a bill called S201. Which is a Senate bill that is on genetic discrimination, particularly coming from the Huntington organization. I'm the sponsor of it now in the House. It passed the Senate, so I've picked it up. I'm running it as a private member's bill. And it is, 4 years ago when Senator Cowan started the bill, there were 2,300 genetic tests you could have. There are now 34,000. So think Angelina Jolie, and breast cancer or cervical cancer or Huntington, this will make it illegal to discriminate against people who have the test and find out they're carrying a gene. So it's quite important. Huntington is, I have had to learn about Huntington's disease in the last 6 months. Horrendous. So thank you.
Pam, was there someone
else?
I think so, yes.
And then I have another one.
So just from the, I'm sort of getting a sense that there's an anticipation of judicial cases that will examine interesting or important borderline cases where someone may have given advanced consent in the form of a will or something, or a power of attorney or some advanced directive, and then their family or doctor feels that actually their quality of life is not that bad or something. I'm just sort of confused about why the government drafted what you both seem to be admitting is a less authentic reading of your findings.
So let me, this one I didn't get into very clearly earlier. To explain this a little bit, the Carter decision was I'd say here. It was a kind of a floor. Our committee decided to anticipate possible other things that could come in. And there was nothing in the Carter decision about advance directives. So that was something we added, and we kind of had a stretch report. So we, here was the floor, we went to the ceiling, or not quite the ceiling, there was things we didn't put in, believe it or not. We kind of thought the government would come in between, and it didn't. So we're still gonna have to do a lot of policy work to get the ceiling, and there may be legal challenges, but they're not gonna be based on Carter, they'd have to be brand new legal challenges. So it'd be something brand new. The legislation, though, calls for terminal illness.
Yeah.
That's become the problem in the Alberta decision, because it's kind of in the basement and the subflooring of Carter. It's below it.
Yeah.
So our committee thought would be somewhere between Carter and the ceiling. Came in a little below it, very cautious piece of legislation. That will be tested, I think, it already was, and we now have eight cases in Canada that are already outside of the legislation. So it'll go back up quite quickly. I'm not worried about the floor of Carter because there's jurisprudence, legal proceedings that will, precedent that will say that. But Canadians are gonna have to work on this part through political advocacy, through changing it, maybe a court case, but more likely it's gonna be a policy case because it's not part of Carter. It'll have to be a whole new case.
Is this on? Dr. Graham, I have a couple of observations. The first one is that requiring more litigation is unfortunate because litigation is so expensive and it takes years. My dad died of ALS something like 35 years ago, and the day before he died, the doctors, this was in Montreal, went to him and said, "Mr. Graham, we're going to put a hole in your neck so that your secretions will drain, and we'll put a hole in your throat so that we can you can breathe, and we'll put a hole in your stomach so that we can feed you." And he looked at them and he said, "Are you people out of your mind?" And he died that night, and I'm not sure why he died that night, because I didn't think he was terminal at that stage, but that's my background. I think the legislation is important to protect the medical and medical people in general. Physician-assisted dying has been going on for hundreds of years. It's been going on in Canada for 100 years. People in intensive care units, people with terminal cancer usually, are given increasing doses of morphine and Valium and those kind of drugs. And this has been going on forever. And so the legislation, to some extent, is important to protect those medical people. My final point is that I don't think very many doctors are going to be interested in this. The average GP won't know where to start until the colleges put in place a process. The average GP would not know what to do. It's interesting that the drugs may not be available in future, because some of the drugs are the same drugs they use for executions in the States. And the medical pharmacy companies are refusing to supply them. Just a few observations.
And we did go through those issues around the actual pharmaceuticals involved, how we're going to do it. The colleges and the faculties of medicine as well are going to figure out how to do this. Right now, about 32% of doctors surveyed have said that they are open to doing it. And if you take out the physicians who don't actually have patients, I mean, they have patients, but they're surgeons or they are radiologists or they're not in direct patient care, you take them out, the number of doctors who are refusing to do it will actually be quite small. Our committee was really clear that conscience objections should be allowed. We believe that no doctor should be forced to do that. We wanted it actually in the legislation. It's in the preamble, and there's now an amendment that I think should have been right in the legislation, just to say doctors aren't forced to do that. We did, however, take language out of the colleges of physicians and surgeons from Ontario that said, However, they would be required to make an effective referral. And that was not, some doctors said, well, I'm so objecting to it, I can't even make a referral. We say that the patient's rights trump, in the end, the doctor's rights. At that stage, we didn't think it was fair for a suffering patient to have to go to Google to find a doctor. We thought the doctor should give a continuity of care. That's still gonna be debated. Well, the pharmaceuticals, they're solving that problem in Europe, so we'll find a way to do it. And medical doctors in this country are pretty amazing. I have great trust in doctors' ability to figure this one out.
Do we have time for two questions?
Okay, yeah. And then I'd like to just quickly.
One here and one there.
It's not really a question, it's totally different from what we've been hearing so far, I think. I worked extended care nursing for 20 years, and I'm probably suffering post-traumatic stress and stuff, I don't know. But as we nurse, and you see people in all different stages, you see your Alzheimer's people whose family can't accept what they're seeing, and we can't be somebody else. We think that they don't like life because they don't recognize us or anything, and I think it's our loss as opposed to theirs. But meanwhile, we also see people who can't feed themselves, don't seem to have any quality of life, but meanwhile, we're still sitting there putting spoons in their mouths, and they can aspirate and everything else. And it always has your brain wondering what is life about, what is quality of life, and all of that sort of stuff. I think when it comes to medical assistance in dying, when somebody's competent, yes, that's wonderful. But the other thing is, when it comes to the other thing with all this talk and all this legislation you continue to talk about, it must take a lot of time and a lot of money, but meanwhile, nurses everywhere are being replaced. We're told that the complexity of care is getting worse and worse. We need more people that have experience to deal with this stuff. But meanwhile, the government is just taking money away from nursing care, right, left, and center. So it really, what I think is, no matter what is said, that we can't afford the people who are all aging. And so we're gonna cut down the nursing care so people actually die faster. And so it gives me a lot of hopelessness, so that when I am suffering from depression, that I just wonder, how do you keep the energy to want to live? And if this is what it looks like, do I really want to live? And so maybe that's when you look at the people who have mental health problems that should actually have the right to end their suffering as well. So there's all sorts of, it's all so complex and so incredible how we do things, like what we're doing to our environment, what we're doing, but meanwhile we're spending so much time on this, and meanwhile, we have wars all over the place, and it just boggles my mind.
Let me first thank you for your nursing care.
Thank you.
Nurses, how many nurses, nursing students, retired nurses, nurse practitioners are in the room? Thank you. We found in our committee that when we talked to physicians, they analyzed it from here, and theoretically, nurses came in and say, we want to help our patients. And it was really very moving to listen to nurses. And we can't solve the problems of nursing budgets, but I think Canadians will line up behind the nurses. So thank you for your work.
One last question.
Okay. Hi. Yes, nurses. Of course, nurses. Always nurses. I'm a family doctor, and just to your comments about GPs not getting it, I can tell you now more than ever, GPs are invested in palliative care and learning about pain management. And I came to it and to palliative care because I gave up obstetrics, and within 3 years had an adult practice, and my older patients are dying and they need help, and you need to learn to manage pain. But I think the college has taken a big role, and so has the provincial palliative program, to get family doctors and give them opportunities to train them. And so therefore, with your work with the college, there's no reason, just like with abortions, you would get doctors who would not refer. would not refer the patient themselves, but then would not give names of another doctor to refer. But the college can keep a list for the public to access of doctors who would be able to provide assistance. And this is where I think you really have to capitalize on using the colleges as, and the medical associations as, in as devices to reach all doctors. I mean, it's sort of natural. And the other thing about advanced directives, I don't know, it seems that there's a real hang up around that issue, and it's kind of got to be sorted out. And I don't know where the fear is coming from. It seems like it's fear driven not to include it, fear on behalf of the government that it's going to get sticky and awkward and there will be difficulties. Whereas patients aren't afraid, they want to put their foot down and say, this is what I want. I don't know if it's quite a comparison, but my mom died of ovarian cancer a year and a half ago, and it took quite a long time, and mom and dad had lots of afternoons to work out their medical, their advanced care directives and what they wanted and what they didn't want. My mom was very adamant she didn't want anything done. If things went kaputsky, she goes to the hospital, don't pick up an IV, don't do anything. Well, it seems to me like the policy has to have in it the ability to change your mind or for other people to have inputs.
And
so maybe this is
the time
to
stop.
On that, is your practice full? Because I'm sure people here right now are really quite impressed. So that's a shout out to the doctors. We did the nurses, a shout out to the doctors, because people keep saying there's no palliative care. That's the capital P palliative care as in specialists. GPs in this country, family docs across this country are doing palliative care. And they're doing it exceptionally well. Not perfectly, nobody is perfect in anything we do, but yeah, we'll shout out those there, and advanced directives, we need to work that out between patients, doctors, and figure it out.
Thank you very much. I am gonna hang around if you have any questions for me. I wanted to thank you for your comments. My view of supporting the government is exactly what Rob just said. I was so impressed as he would report out to our caucus about the weighty questions, the long, long list of them that the committee was grappling with and working 12, 16 hour days, I don't know how you did it, he knows. For me to be part of a majority decision gives me as much as it gives Rob to push. And I believe in service to the community, that's the right way to go. But in our community, I think we are fairly well lined up with that committee. That is not the same right across the country. So I have a representative role, but I also, in that capacity, want to make this better and farther reaching for all Canadians. And so being together with all Canadians in that process, I think is half the battle. But more than anything, I would just like to ask you to join me in thanking Rob. It's been an extraordinary day. You represent the government well. I think he did an excellent job of representing conservative senators and conservative and members and NDP as well. And that's another big part of how we're trying to represent Canadians. Thank you so much for coming.
You can still get your fairy.
Yeah.